transition. So 2003, I want to talk about Knebworth.
Wouldn't it be nice? Wouldn't it be nice if we had just some sort of grand piano here with me on stage? Wouldn't that be lovely? Maybe if we could just get one of my closest, dearest friends, Mr. Max Beesley, to play that piano with me. Fuck me! Hello! Nice to see you, son. Ladies and gentlemen, your friend and mine, Mr. Max Beesley.
Sorry, that ties in with... So 2003, yeah. Just before I went back to the UK,
yeah,
at the end of the year, I was living by myself in my manager, Beth Holden Garland, who's just an amazing woman. She had a studio apartment on Marina Del Rey, and I had nowhere to stay. She says, you can stay there while you're hustling. I was like, okay. Yeah. I walked into the antique, you know, the cars on Santa Monica.
Yeah.
To look at the old classic cars.
Yeah.
And Rob walked in, Robbie, and I'd not seen him for about 6 years. And we were very close years earlier when I used to play with Take That. Mm-hmm. And he went, I can't believe it. I said, I can't believe it. He said, you want to come up to the house? I says, yeah. So I went up to the house and he said, it's a nice house. I feel a bit weird. I said, don't be weird about anything, mate. You work so hard. And he is a phenomenal grafter. And he's a great frontman.
So unimpressed, but so in awe. Such a saint, such a whore. Thank you. So self-aware, so full of shit. So indecisive, so adamant.
And he said, why don't you move in here? This was like the end of 2002, sorry. And I went, yeah. Okay. And... We helped it helped me because I had somewhere to stay, and it hopefully helped him because I used to make him laugh a lot. Yeah. And then he finished tours coming up and need a pianist and percussionist. You fancy it or what? And I says, yeah, definitely. Let's go, man. Mm-hmm. And that Knebworth gig was one of numerous 35 gigs that summer that we did all over the UK. Brilliant tour.
Oh, Mr. Bojangle. Mr. Mr. Bojangles, come back and dance, dance, and dance.
Having that energy, what's that like? Seeing that crowd.
Great. It's great. The opening, he'll never get a better opener than Let Me Entertain You. That's the opener for the ages. It's brilliant. When we started that, and then Chris, and then all the dancers come on, the horns are playing. That, I mean, I'm getting goosebumps now. That is a massive, and then the crowd just start going boom, boom, boom.
Yeah.
That's a big high. That gig. That was a big, big high, man. And to do with your mate. Sorry.
Did you know at the time what it was? I mean.
Oh no, you do. You know when you're doing these gigs, you're going. There was 150,000 people here, man, and it's 3 nights. You're flying in on the helicopter. You're getting everything's there for you. Your sticks are ready. Everything's in ear monitors. Beer, bang, boom, on stage, let's go. And you've got everything nailed down, every single part, you know, the arrangements. It's just easy. It's like, that was unbelievable, that gig. I loved it. But equally, you know, you can go to Osaka and play the Club Quattro with 400 people in front of you with Incognito and get or the Brand New Heavies and get a massive buzz because the people are right there. Knebworth, Wembley Stadium. Those big arenas, they're out there. Knebworth didn't feel that bad actually for some reason. I think it's because I was high up on a riser. You can see, you can feel it, you know. But yeah, just brilliant show.
You were in the sticks too, or just the piano for a couple of lips?
No, percussion, massive percussion rig at the back. Yeah, congas, bongos, djembe, timbales, everything. Yeah,
yeah. And you just came up with your solo album.
That's basically all my old favorite session musicians.
Okay.
I just called them and said, can I send you these demos? And if you like them, will you come and record with me? But like Steve Gadd's my favorite drummer in the world. You know, Walt Fowler, Zappa's old horn player, Gadd, Dean Parks, Louis Conti. I mean, these guys are all, they're on basically every album you've ever listened to. Joni Mitchell, Ricky Lee Jones, Steely Dan, Marvin Gaye. They're the masters. And they came in and we made a great, great funky album.
And when that's out when?
That's September the 8th, I think it's got to be out, because it's got to be out before the 10th for Grammy nominations or something. I think it's the 8th, so okay. We're going to get it out. Max Beasley's High Vibes. Zeus. That's the name of the album.
Zeus.
Yeah.
And then we'd be remiss to talk about Hijack, which just came out, which I thought was fantastic. How did that come about? Tell what it was like working on that show. You know, I'd love to hear a little bit more about that.
Hijack was great. And Idris Elba suggested me for that role, which is really lovely, you know, and they called me about it. And I think I only got the first two episodes, and I was like, the writing's great. And I was like, but I'm not sure what this guy, what's he going to do, you know? And but I just trusted, I just knew Idris had suggested it. The writing was terrific. And then the director, I'd watched some of the stuff he'd done and went, oh, I've got to do it. And then it progressed a little bit as the show went on. And I think it's terrific television. And you never know how these things go, you know. One thing I do know from this is it's fine doing good work on shows that probably not a lot of people will see, but it's really important trying to do good work on shows that are going to get out there. And my word, this has got out there. So it's their global number one show on Apple. It has been for the last 2 weeks. I mean, it's just amazing, you know, the coverage that you get from a show like that, these streamers. It's made me really think about that, because I'm 52, 25 more summers, maybe. My kids are young. You're going away each year. If you're going away filming Atlanta, Budapest, the UK, whatever, I think the projects have to be of a specific, they've got to tick quite a few boxes. One of them being, right, who's making it and how they're getting it out. I think it's important to think like that, because you're missing time with your children. So the product has to be valuable enough to propel you as an artist to know that you're going to be in better positions on other jobs, and then you can do more work, you can earn more dough, you can provide for your children, you know. If you're lucky enough to be in that position, and I've been lucky, and I've also had the salad days, man, where there's no moves on the board, and it's 8 months, 9 months, 10 months, and not a dollar's come in the account. Yeah. It's hard, and you should never forget the salad days. Vital, you know, when you're swinging and you're a commodity, or you've got a bit of heat on you. Yeah. You've got to remember them salad days.
You got to squeeze the lemon. You got to, if it comes, keep doing it. Keep squeezing
it. Let's go.
Yeah. I you know, I think a lot of it comes like saying yes. I used to, when I was in my 20s, younger, I was just saying, I don't want to do that. You know, and maybe I should have said yes a little bit more. But like you said, like, you got to keep putting yourself out there. And yes, it's scary, and you worry about the kids and the family and those things. So, you know, saying yes and moving forward and moving forward is something that's kind of amazing. And then, and then talking about moving forward, and we'll finish out with Manchester United. This is why we're here. Like,
the Mighty Reds.
Yeah, the Reds, man. So
the Mighty Reds.
Yeah, what's going on? What do you think? What do you think we're about the precipice of the new season? What do you think?
Well, let's see. I mean, City are ridiculous. The end of last season, just ridiculous. The team's just, we've not seen anything like that for a long time. I've seen a few bits and pieces in the news about potential players going, potential players coming. What I do like is, I do like Ten Hag. I think he's a very good coach. I think there is a strong squad there. There's a couple of players that I'm like, he's come up, I think yesterday, that they're like, oh, there's been a couple of offers on him and a few offers on him in the midfield. And I'm like, sell him. Okay. Let's go.
Get him going. Yeah.
Let's go and bring him in. Let's see what this kid's like, the Danish kid. Let's see how he's... you know, he's made some young international appearances, not scored that many for his last team, but the one before that he did, I saw. But let's just see, it might be that thing that we need. I think obviously we know we need a forward that's on fire, and you can put Marcus around on the left. Mm-hmm. He's dangerous. And then we need to midfielder, we need another strong midfielder. I think Casemiro's been amazing. Eriksen's been amazing.
Yeah. Amrabat might be the guy. He's he might bring him in. The guy from Amrabat.
They're thinking of that, right?
Yeah.
And then selling Scott for him, I think. Yeah. He's a big lump. I've met he's a big unit. And I think they were thinking about putting a bid in for Aaron Maguire as well. And let's go.
You gotta think you get rid of De Gea. Okay, you get rid of De Gea, you can get rid of Maguire. Okay, I'm sorry. I know the money and everything, but it's almost like we have to move on from this portion the last 8 years, whatever it is, 5 years, whatever we've been doing. And just kind of like, why are we signing a 35-year-old striker, a 38-year-old striker? Let's move on and let's get things through, you know? And I will say I'm not too crazy about the Mason Mount signing. I don't quite get it. But
midfield.
Yeah. And number seven, I mean, come on, Catana.
I've been up there a few times this year, and I'm not that mass over the moon, like, I'm not like just dancing off the rooftops about it. The one thing that I do think that the United got right this season was the midfield, actually, as it goes. There were some games where they were pinging it all over the place beautifully. I'm trying to think of the game. It was the United Chelsea game in May, I think it was. I think it was 5-1 or 4, I can't remember. But I went with Butty, I went with Nicky Butt, and he had a bet on it 5-1. No, he had a bet on it 5-1, and I had a bet on it 4-1.
Uh-huh.
And, oh no, 3-1 and 4-1, and it must have been 5-1 in the end. I can't remember, but he missed that. We both missed out, but we were gutted. But they looked sharp. And I think what's important is, I know from past squads and managers, the managers haven't had the dressing room. They've not had the power in the dressing room. Some of the older managers that we had with the squad.
Well, between Pogba and Ronaldo and Maguire, there's a big personality.
Yeah. Well, that's right. Yeah. That's right. And as much as I loved Ronaldo, that was a genius move. Ten Hag just going, got to go. That's the end. And I loved him. And I watched him since he was when he came to the club, you know. But Ten Hag has got the dressing room and he's got the respect of the players. And I think he is the man for the job. I like him a lot. I think he's going to do great. I think we'll do great. I mean, it's just City. It's top three. I mean, can we win it next year? Maybe not next year, maybe the year after, depending on how the new players settle in the squad. I mean, this week's going to be very busy with any of the transfers.
Yeah.
But
City lost a solid player, Gundogan in the middle. Let's see what happens with Silva. Gvardiol in the back. I mean, no one's won it four years on the bounce. You know, just no one's happened. I mean, even United has that. So it's like, okay, is this the year maybe they stumble a bit? We'll see. I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah, it's certainly exciting. It's certainly exciting going there. And I used to go to I went to both Champions League finals that we lost, obviously, I travel, but I used to go on the away games as well, which was just mayhem, absolutely crazy, but great to see. And we'll see what happens, man. But it's still exciting to get up there. I still love it. I still watch it every week. And when I'm filming back in the UK, it's like every Monday when I come in, the crew, the Sparks, the drivers, most of them are Chelsea or Arsenal or Tottenham fans, you know, if they hammer me if we've been beaten, you know what I mean? So it's going to be nice going boom back, you know.
It's great banter. And that you're friends with Beckham in regards to his team down in Miami. Have you talked to him about Messi coming in?
No, I don't know David that well, to be honest with you. I don't really know David. Ryan's my friend, a friend of mine, a very good friend of mine, Giggs, and Boy. But I don't really know David. I mean, I've been out for dinner with David. He's lovely. But one of my other friends is friends with him. And we were talking about just this last week about Messi. And he's like, right, he scored. I said, well, let's hope he has scored, brother, you know. So I don't know what the deal is there. What, did he get paid insane money?
Oh, my God. It's just incredible. He turned down Saudi. So whatever he's getting, it's Apple money at this point, you know.
Right. Right.
But I think it's good for the league. You know, I struggle to go down and watch the LAFC games just because, you know, it's a Wednesday night or something. You know, maybe we got to go, maybe we got to entertain a little bit more. I don't know, but
you should give it a go. I go to Salford when I'm up there.
You do?
With Giggsy. I go down to the Salford games, and it's exciting to see those clubs that are struggling but trying, and there's the young players and they're giving it a go, and you know the stadium's not great, and it's like it's a great different perspective to see football from that angle, and I like it. And you can see the people who are as passionate about it there as they are, you know, in the Stretford end when you're at Old Trafford with 78,000 people there, you know. So give it a go, man, here in LA. I don't think I can. I think it's shite, but that's because I've grown up on British football, you know.
But you should. I was a season ticket holder at LAFC, and then I didn't, you know, it kind of fell apart just because of how they structured it and whatever. But we've been talking to Sheffield FC, which is the oldest football club in the world. We worked with them a little bit, and that was the first club why we're doing the local pundit. It's like, hey, you know, there's obviously Wrexham with Ryan Reynolds and Rob McElhenney, but like, I was like, they're the third, so like, what's the first? So we've been working with Sheffield FC. So I'd like to go see a game there. And they talk about the stadium, and there's a pub right there. Like, that's what I'd like to see more about. And I don't think we really have that in the States, but I wish.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah. All of that. Yeah, yeah. And it's Sheffield. It's a working town in it as well. So it'll be proper. You'll get the real deal there, no doubt.
Yeah. Yeah. And lastly, like, so what's next for you? Obviously, we're in the strike and, you know, this is all going to pass. What, you know, obviously, you know, we'll get through it as we always do. What's next for you in your career and life? And, you know, obviously, I'm really generous with your time. So thank you very much.
Oh, no. Thank you for asking me, my brother. I appreciate it very much. Next for me, I'm finishing writing a film for Malcolm McDowell and I. It's a two-hander, father and son.
Mm-hmm. Max. Oh, there he is.
There he is. Yeah. Yeah, so I'm finishing writing a film for Malcolm McDowell and I, which should get made because it's a small budget, but it's beautiful. Malcolm's a good, close friend of mine.
Yeah.
Father and son, story of redemption, really. And we'll shoot that here, which will be great, whenever we can. Yeah. I want to get the Mr. Goodnight made, which is a film set in Manchester in the 60s about a very serious gangster firm of guys that were safe blowers. That I've been trying to make that for 10 years, but that's more... Yeah, it's more of a bigger budget, so it's tricky to get the dough. I've shot The Gentleman for Guy Ritchie, the TV series of that, which is coming out. I don't know when that is coming out, March or April on Netflix. That was incredibly fun, a lot of fun, great character. And I love
two or three times, right? You worked with Guy twice, two or three times, right?
Twice now, yeah. I love it. I love working with him, man. I love it. It's that's where you earn your stripes. He'll just drop you in and go, right, Maxie, I need a bit of this, that, bing, 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 go over there, a bit of Bunny, work him, and then pull him into the car and then drive off and then pick the phone up and a bit of Bunny on there. We're going in 15, 14, 13. What the fuck? And that's it. It's on you. Boom. And... Yeah, but I love it. It's like a jazz gig playing with Guy. Filming with Guy's like you're a jazz musician. And, you know, I've said this before, Miles is on stage. He just goes, blow, go. You know, so I love working with Guy. He's a really interesting filmmaker. I love him as a person as well. He's very cerebral, very clever man. He's helped me out with a couple of things, actually. Filmed that, writing the thing for Malcolm, trying to get Mr. Goodnight made. There's a couple of jobs that have come in, but I can't do them yet because we're on strike, so we have to just hold off on them, unfortunately. So let's see. But great, a job has come in, you know. Listen, man,
this will pass.
It's just like I said, even if you're doing a $50 million movie and all of your work, Scorsese's directing it, you're doing everything with De Niro, let's go.
Yeah.
Great to be here. And then if you're going to do a bit of theatre, Royal Court, London, 10 weeks, bang, let's go. A short film for a mate, it's great. Oh, what a great, let's go. It's all the same, man. You just got to keep on keeping on. That's it.
it's a great attitude, and you know, I totally agree with you, and I the say yes attitude, I think it's great, and I really appreciate your time coming on, and it's nice to talk to you and catch up, and
you too, my brother.
Too, and we'll catch up soon, and thank you for coming on the show. Appreciate it.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for asking me. I appreciate it too, my brother.
Thank you very much, man. We'll talk soon. All right, Mr. Max Beesley.
They all clap and cheer, then they leave. And maybe they will come back if I produce the goods again and again. But as I get older, the bones start aching, my head is battered, but I'm still flattered night after night. When they arrive and cheer my name, I cannot skive from my job. This is plain. It's insane what I feel every night. But my crowd seem to make it all right.